Finding My Bella Vita, a story of family, food, fame, and working out who you are. Written and read by Pia Miranda. An unabridged Hachette Australia audio edition. Produced by Hachette Australia, an imprint of Hachette Australia Proprietary Limited. Text copyright Pia Miranda 2023. Recording copyright Hachette Australia Proprietary Limited 2023. Recorded at Square Sound Studios, Melbourne, Australia. All rights reserved. The dedication reads, for Lily and James. Prologue. Every day on top of the dirt is a good day. Nonna Angelina. There were many times while writing this book that I wondered, oh my God, am I unhinged? Am I annoying? Could I possibly be the asshole that @oz_mum85 told me I was on Instagram? But writing about my life has also enabled me to see how far I've come, how much I've changed, and how all of my imperfections are actually okay. It's a strange thing to live and breathe and walk through the world, never quite sure of who you are. But it's a sensation that many of us are familiar with. If you're one of the lucky ones, this is only your lot when you're young. As you age and settle into yourself, you find the things that matter to you, that soothe your soul and bring you joy. For some of us, the searching never ends. They say age brings acceptance and wisdom, but I have oscillated throughout my life, even as I've grown older, between this state and the anxiety of being buffeted by what society said defined beauty or belonging, by wanting but not knowing exactly what it was I wanted or how to get it, and by fearing life being snatched away. This fear is what motivated my obsessive drive to matter, to be loved and to not be forgotten. It took a long time for me to realise that the body I was born with should be celebrated despite its betrayals and mysteries. And to genuinely know yourself is to know all the parts of you and all the fragments of life that create who you are. We are not defined by one single thing, but billions of things, big and small, that direct our thoughts and responses. None of it is set in stone. You can change things about yourself, but I now know that it is often the thing you dislike most about yourself that makes you special. So how much do we really need to change after all? It is kind of funny that for many I am forever a teenage girl, captured in celluloid as Josie, a young woman not sure of where she belonged, but determined to live her life honestly and powerfully after growing tired of being defined by others. I would go on to play many other roles in film, on TV and on stage. I would put myself out there on panels and TV shows and prove to myself and others I was the ultimate survivor. It is only now looking back at my life to this point that I can appreciate where I am. In order to come to that understanding, I had to pull apart the jigsaw and sit with all the moments and memories of the people who helped build the person I am. The grief, the fear, the joy, the doubt and disappointments, the loves and triumphs, hates and the hurt. I hope that by sharing my story, I will help other misfits find their place. I hope that it might show that the pressure of growing up between two cultures and having to navigate the constant push and pull of tradition can actually mean your world is richer. Most of all, I hope my story inspires everyone to know that you are never defined by what has been before. You can be whoever you strive to be, and when people expect little of you, that is their weakness, not yours. I hope we can all find our own beautiful life. I think I have. But to get to that point, we have to go back to a small volcanic island in the sea not far from Sicily. It is here that finding my Bella Vita begins. Here it is. Part 1. Chapter 1. Avoid the bad, love the good, because things change in a moment. Sicilian proverb. Sure, this is a story about me, but we are all the people we've become because of the people who came before us. The women in my family played a huge part in helping shape me. strong, defiant women who were born into a world that wasn't quite ready to see them as equals. A world we still have to navigate and battle against, but also one that has given those of us who followed amazing opportunities. So I want to begin by telling you about a woman who had to push against tradition and fear to make a life for herself. And because she did that, I was born. As it turns out, I am not the hero of my story. My Nonna, Angelina, is. When I was a kid, I would listen to Nonna's stories about her life growing up in a very different place. She was born in 1921 in the Mediterranean on a volcanic island off the coast of Sicily, a place of coarse black sand, the smell of sulfur in the air, thermal springs and relentless burning sun. All she knew was her small and simple life. She felt ordinary and insignificant, cemented to the island, and she had no thoughts of ever leaving. Angelina passionately believed that God smiled on her every day. She was the youngest of 10, and as the baby of the family, she felt comforted, protected, loved. Angelina grew into a sweet 15-year-old, and her daily life consisted of helping with the farming and looking after the house with her mother. There was no education available for a girl like her, but she learnt to become proficient with her hands, sewing, cooking, and looking after the goats. One day she was sunning herself while shelling peas for a party when an intense wave of contentment and love overtook her body, and she wondered if it was a sign from God. She looked up to her mother and said, "I think I'll stay here forever and look after this place and never leave your side." "This is enough," she said. "I'm happy." What Angelina didn't know that day was that across the water in Palermo, a young orphan named Salvatore had heard about a man with 10 daughters who was having a party to try to find some husbands for those that weren't yet married. Salvatore was small in stature and big in personality, and his athletic body and tan skin had always been a moderate hit with the ladies, but the clock was ticking and he was feeling the pressure to find himself a suitable wife. Hearing of this party piqued his interest. 10, he thought. Surely the statistics are in my favour that one of them might be suitable for me. Okay, let's just admit he probably didn't use the word statistics because he hadn't been taught to read or write, but it works for the story. Anyway, back to Sicily in 1936. Salvatore jumped on a boat with a couple of his buddies and they headed off for a boys' weekend to Volcano, one of the smaller Aeolian islands north of Sicily. They each had hopes of finding themselves a lovely buxom woman to settle down and have children with. Big boobs were all the rage back then in Sicily. When they turned up on the dock, the group of mates were shocked by the island's undeveloped landscape and dilapidated housing, as well as the pungent smell of sulfur. They thought about aborting their mission, but they'd committed to finding wives and they had come a fair way, so off they went. When they finally found the home where the party was being held, the festivities had already begun. It was surprisingly fun and full of energy. Set outdoors under the stars, the balmy weather had everyone in a festive mood, helped by the amazing food and wine being served up. Sicily is known for its seafood and pasta dishes, and food was a big focus for any celebration. No party would have been complete without fish, pasta and biscotti, sfinge and grappa, even in the poorer rural areas like Volcano. The boys danced and mingled and had such a good time that some of them forgot they were on the lookout for a bride. Not Salvatore, though. In true Sicilian style, he was like a dog with a bone. He didn't want to leave until he had struck gold. Parties were a rare treat on the island. And as Angelina looked around the room, she was filled with a sense of excitement and adventure. She had her dark hair pulled up into a loose bun and was wearing a new blue dress that hugged her more than ample bosom. She felt the loveliest she had ever felt in her modest 15 years. She may have been the baby of the family, but on this night, she was a young woman charged with an energy she hadn't felt before. It was early in the evening when she looked up and saw a darkly tanned boy staring at her intensely. He wasn't tall, but he looked fit and strong, and she couldn't help noticing his amazing blue eyes. He seemed to stand apart from everyone else and his serious look caught her attention. After a moment, they shared a shy smile and he walked up to introduce himself. Then Salvatore asked her very sweetly if she would like to dance. Angelina could tell there was more to this boy than he was letting on. He had an air of bravado about him, but he was charming and attentive, and they talked and danced into the early hours of the morning. As they danced close, she felt an unfamiliar surge of desire. It was an overwhelming and delightful feeling, and combined with the rush of being the recipient of unbridled attention, it made her feel dizzy. This was the first time she felt like someone saw her, really saw into her soul. And it was as terrifying as it was breathtaking. Most girls her age were engaged or married, and she'd mostly given up on that idea for herself. But that night, she felt a thrilling sense of possibility. Angelina didn't want the party to end. But of course, no matter how much you want time to pause, it keeps ticking on. Eventually, the music stopped, and all the guests, including Salvatore, left. Angelina woke early the next morning and was cleaning the kitchen when she heard a cough behind her. She turned to see Salvatore standing at the door with a bunch of flowers and a cheeky smile, and it felt like her heart was going to stop beating. That was the start of a magical 2-year courtship for the couple, and it was a courtship in every sense. For almost 2 years, Angelina refused to give in to Salvatore's physical advances. And even though he tried to woo her, he respected Angelina's commitment to her God-fearing chastity. When she turned 17, he could wait no longer, and they were finally married in the small white church that she had been worshipping in every Sunday for her whole life. The church was ordinary and modest, with a row of cobbled stairs that led to the entrance. Angelina's dress was simple and meticulously sewn by her mother, and although it was made from basic cotton with a plain piece of tulle as a veil, the small embroidered sleeves and the starkness of the white fabric made her feel elegant and grown up. The cream-coloured paint on the church's walls was peeling off in some places, but the enormous picture of Jesus and the Madonna hanging prominently above the altar made the whole space feel grand to her. As she walked up the aisle and looked into Salvatore's eyes, Angelina knew her new life was about to start and felt a combined sense of fear and belonging. When they were pronounced husband and wife, Salvatore leant in and kissed her forcefully and passionately on the lips with all of the pent-up energy of a young man in love. Years later, she would tell her granddaughters, me included, that this was her first kiss ever, as she encouraged us to rebuff advances from any boy we were dating and never let them touch us until we were married. Sure, Nonna. What Nonna didn't realise as she began her new life as a married woman was that she, along with other women around the world, was about to send her husband off to war. Some would never return, and others would return broken. Nonna learnt the harsh lesson that her fate and that of her new husband was determined not by something they did or desired, but by a wider world that was rapidly changing. Decisions made in government chambers thousands of miles away would irrevocably alter the future they were anticipating. That's the thing about war. The actions of just one person can destroy so many lives. So in a cruel twist of fate, not long after marrying and only the day after Angelina discovered she was pregnant, Salvatore was shipped off to fight in the Navy. And unfortunately, this is where a new chapter of their love story begins. Chapter 2. Death finds everyone, and the earth renews itself. Sicilian proverb. Soon after the wedding, the newlyweds had moved to the larger island of Lipari, and although it was not much larger than Volcano, Angelina found it unfamiliar and lonely without her husband. Her pregnancy was not easy, and news of the horrors of war would reach her and make her cry. She tried to enjoy the feeling of new life growing inside her, but A darkness followed her like an unwelcome passenger. Salvatore had promised he would return for the birth of their first child, but as the due date grew closer and still he wasn't home, sadness clouded her every thought and action. She was scared she would never see Salvatore again and worried constantly that something would go wrong with their child. Southern Italians are very superstitious. They look for signs in all sorts of places, and there is a belief that the gift of a divine sixth sense runs through their blood. Angelina's impending sense of doom was difficult to shake, and when she went into labour, she carried not the excitement she was expecting, but fear and dread. When it suddenly began, the labour was a shock to her young body, and the women surrounding her bellowing instructions in a furious manner left her feeling very alone. This was definitely not the joyous experience she had prayed for. The pain went on and on, intensifying into a searing agony that felt as if her body was being torn apart. For a brief moment, she thought she was going to die, and she prayed to the Madonna to save her. Then suddenly, there was no pain, just peace and silence. Angelina had witnessed enough births to know that silence was not good, and she held her breath as she waited for her baby to cry. She could hear commotion and panic from the women who had only moments before been yelling instructions to her, and she shut her eyes. She didn't need to ask the question. She knew this day of joy had turned into one of despair and death. When Salvatore finally made it home on leave to see his new family, he walked in with a beaming smile, but discovered an empty cot and a broken wife. Devastated, he stayed with Angelina for as long as he could, but the duty of war would eventually call him back, and he returned to his ship. Before departing, he left Angelina a new gift, another life growing inside her, a boy who would bring her joy and mend her despair. As the war raged, Salvatore's trips home would come sporadically. Sal would surprise Angelina with a visit, and her world would feel complete for a few short weeks. Her anxiety for him was constant, though, and there were so many near misses. She was worried God would soon come for his soul, like he had so many others. Salvatore was a gunner on his ship, and he was good at it. He had a masterful eye and a fierce, stubborn heart that made him one of the most liked and consistent men in his naval squadron. The fighting had been long and arduous, dragging on for years, but Salvatore's steely determination and patriotism kept pushing him forward. Like most of the poorer men in Sicily, Salvatore was uneducated, and he'd been taught from a young age to find value in hard work, not in deep thought. So, although he didn't grasp the complexities of the war he was fighting or question the ethics of risking his life for fascist regimes, he was led by his passion and loyalty for the country he loved and the people he had left behind. Not everyone gets to be on the right side of history. In 1943, Operation Husky, the Allied invasion of Sicily, was just taking hold, and Italian naval ships were under incredible pressure as a large campaign to take down Mussolini and his fascist regime began. There was an elevated sense of stress among the naval officers as the casualties grew and the number of deaths became overwhelming. These things were always on Salvatore's mind, but he never stopped as he blindly fought for what he thought was right. In a strange twist of fate, a day finally came when he had to stop. He was preparing to take his place at his regular gunning spot when suddenly his stomach churned and he felt his insides catch fire as he doubled over in pain. His stomach cramps were excruciating and he began throwing up all over himself. As he lay on the wet tiles vomiting, Sal saw his best mate standing above him. "You look terrible," his mate said. "Oh, that bastard whitebait got me, I think," Sal said and groaned. The moment he mentioned the fish he'd eaten, he was vomiting again. "I'll take your place tonight, Migliori," his friend said. Even though Sal knew it was his mate's long overdue night off, he couldn't argue. He could barely stand. There was no way he could fire a gun. He felt a pat on his back and heard some reassuring words that he couldn't quite decipher. Then he passed out. He wasn't sure how long he slept, but an epic boom woke Sal and he struggled to his feet. Gathering his thoughts, he realised their ship had been hit. He raced up to the deck to check on his friend who'd taken over his post. Instead, he found a gaping hole where his cannon had been and was shocked to find only a bloody foot. It took him a second to realise what was in front of him and what it meant. Sal was pushed back by a crowd of men scrambling to safety. He was alive, and his mate was dead. The reality of his tragic luck set in. Whitebait, he thought. I was saved by some miniature fish left in the sun for too long. How was that God's plan? He pondered on his dead baby and best friend and wondered if God was punishing him. And for the first time, he questioned whether there was anyone watching over him at all. He could feel a dark, volcanic anger bubbling away in his blood, and he was scared of what would happen if it finally erupted. Angelina remained at home while this tragedy and many others that war brought unfolded in her husband's life, raising their child as best she could on her own. With every visit home, she could see Sal's usually bright eyes becoming darker and his soul becoming harder to read. There was little contact from him during those years of war. Sometimes it was 6 months between visits, sometimes a year. But every time he was home, she felt that God was on their side and maybe things would be all right, that he would be all right. It was getting hard to survive without him. Wartime rationing meant food was scarce, and with so many of its men fighting in the war, the island community was struggling, and so was Angelina. She took small jobs, sewing and cleaning, to make money, but there was barely enough to buy food for her and her son Renato. The early years of their child's life unfolded without his father in the house. Following one of Sal's rare visits, Angelina found she was pregnant again with a baby that thrived in her belly despite these difficult conditions. When he was born, Angelina looked into his dark black eyes and knew this boy would find trouble. He had a stubbornly determined and mischievous spirit that was obvious even then. She named him Vincenzo, which means to conquer. As the boys grew, Vincenzo kept Angelina busy. He was a feisty firecracker who was always getting into trouble. The war finally ended, and yet she received no word from Sal. She didn't know if he was alive or dead. Looking after Renato and Vincenzo helped distract her from dark thoughts, but the fear was ever present and only God was there to listen. Though Angelina didn't know it, Salvatore was alive and was so traumatised that he was too terrified to travel in a vehicle in case it was blown up. So he walked for 36 days before finally getting a boat and eventually making it home to his beloved family. When she saw him, Angelina finally let out the tears she'd been holding in for so many years. Sal was home and they could start their life as a family. God had blessed them as she'd hoped he would. But, like most post-war family stories, the jubilance of survival and reuniting was quickly followed by the reality of the shattered world they had to live in. There was little food and no work. The ration for their family of four was only 200 grams of bread a day. As she prepared for the winter, Angelina wandered around town gathering up flags she found among the rubble to make clothes for her children. With his family often hungry, Salvatore wrestled with an overwhelming sense of failure that tortured his proud Sicilian heart. He obsessed over how to change their fate, which was looking more hopeless with every day that passed. There were rumblings around town about free tickets to Australia, where there were opportunities waiting for men who were willing to work hard. Salvatore started to wonder if he could go and then come back and migliorare la vita, improve their life. Sal was a complex mix of a man. He had an inflated Sicilian ego with the soul of a scared child. He saw things in black and white. There was an anger that had always burned inside him, and as his circumstances grew more challenging, he worried that the fire of that anger would engulf him, or worse, incinerate everything and everyone around him. He was known for his passionate attitude, and although his fervour for an attractive woman was never fully dimmed by marriage, his love for his family overrode everything. Finally, like many young men with big hearts and no prospects, he decided to join a group looking for a better life for their families by heading to Australia. In doing that, they left all those families behind. Nonna never shared much information about what those long weeks on the ship were like for her husband. I don't think she ever really knew, but I do know that many of the boats were overcrowded and the men lived in dormitory-style accommodation on board. They passed the time playing cards and sharing stories about the families they had left behind, but Salvatore didn't talk much about any of it to Angelina. He kept the past locked away deep inside, a trick he had learned when his parents had died of the Spanish flu while he was young, and he was shipped off to live with a family that cared little for him. With his determined spirit and a capacity to push down his feelings and just get on with things, Salvatore arrived in Australia ready to improve his life and that of his family. Angelina was alone again, struggling to look after the boys and herself while waiting for news. I wonder if she ever looked back to that moment with her mother when she was 15, when she said that everything she wanted was right there and that she never wanted to leave. The war years had changed everything. Now it seemed to her the islands offered only hardship and early death. She felt the only help and protection she could hope for would come from Jesus and the Madonna. So she prayed. She prayed through her starvation. She prayed when her hungry children screamed. She prayed for work. And she prayed for her family to be reunited. It would be 2 years before her prayers were answered, and Angelina and her sons finally boarded a boat to reunite with Salvatore in Australia after facing another trauma. A tearful and dramatic farewell to her siblings and parents as she left the islands that had been her home since birth. The moment the ship set sail, however, Angelina looked up and saw the sun shining through the clouds, and she knew God was with her. She wrapped her two boys up in her arms, and they watched Lipari and Volcano disappear into the distance. My father, Vincenzo, says he doesn't remember anything about this trip. It's just a black hole in his mind. So I sometimes wonder if he inherited his father's capacity for locking his feelings away. He was 6 years old at the time. The journey to a new land would take nearly 8 weeks, and when Angelina finally stepped foot onto Australian soil, nothing was as she expected. Salvatore met her at the ship, and the first home they shared was a small, dank, rural house with a dirt floor. The house was surrounded by hundreds of pigs who would scratch and bang on the door all night long. It was worse than anything she could ever have imagined. She sobbed quietly into her blankets at night, praying to God to help her return to Italy and the home she loved. She was homesick and wanted to leave every day, but Salvatore and the boys needed her to be strong. So she locked her pain away deep inside and pushed through one day at a time. You may notice a theme emerging here. Omerta, the mafia code of honour that decreed silence was an obligation, has often seemed very pertinent to how my forebears sometimes chose to live. Eventually, God did smile on Angelina, and the family moved to a small town called Tatura in rural Victoria. Here, her new home had a floor and windows and no paddock of pigs outside the walls. The homesickness abated and she created a real home. In Tatura, Angelina and Salvatore were blessed with another baby boy they called Giorgio. Together, they farmed tomatoes, which were supplied to make white crow tomato sauce, and they started to see their dreams come to life. The constant worry about finding food became a memory. Angelina had so many tomatoes to cook with, she could make fresh passata for their pasta every night. But there were still worries. Vincenzo was getting into all sorts of trouble in this small town, often coming home beaten and bloody from fights at school. Nobody liked wogs in 1960s Australia. Derogatory comments were common in the school playground, and the homemade salami that he took for lunch just added fuel to the fire. Vincenzo, who had inherited his father's simmering anger, refused to take shit, in his words, and fought back with his fists. Apart from those moments, it was a pretty good life. But after years of contented country life, Salvatore's restless spirit wanted more. They decided to try their luck in the big city. The move to Melbourne was a good one for the family, and city life suited them all. Angelina felt completely settled at last. Some of her sisters had come to Australia by this point and were close by, so the pang for Italy lessened. Salvatore opened a fruit shop and changed from being gruff and angry a great deal of the time to become a contented man with confidence and purpose. Angelina noticed how he strode around with his chest puffed out, a camel cigarette balanced on his ear as he greeted his customers with a smile and a look of pride. Although the land of the volcanoes called to her from time to time, its voice was getting softer and mostly only came at night when Angelina put her head on the pillow and tried to fall asleep to the loud sound of the trains rattling through Carnegie Station. The only hint of worry that my grandfather faced in those years related to Italian turf wars at Paran Market, where he bought his produce. Sal was a man of strict principles. He wanted to run his business and look after his family with a proud heart and without answering to anyone. "We are Australian now," he would tell his boys, "and we must leave all thoughts of the old country behind." Sal's attitude was what had helped him survive those turbulent years, but perhaps it was also what led to his life being cut so short. On the last day of Salvatore's life, he grabbed his Australian driver's license, of which he was so proud, popped his packet of camel cigarettes into his back pocket, and grabbed a few coins for a coffee. He kissed his beloved Angelina, then headed out into the still dark early morning to make his way to the markets before the boys were even stirring. Later that day, two messengers of death came to Angelina's door and gave her the news. Her husband had died in a freak accident at the market. Italians know how to express grief, and so her wailing began immediately. The police officers held her as she cried, but she fell to the ground. When her wailing stopped, an officer handed her the contents of Salvatore's pockets. Half a pack of camels, a few coins, and the Australian driver's license. She slowly walked over to the table that was set for dinner with a beautiful red and white check tablecloth and matching serviettes. Angelina kissed the items, grabbed a serviette, and wrapped up Sal's belongings. She tied the serviette in a knot and swore she'd never open it again. Maybe it was just a terrible accident. I guess we will never know how my nonno ended up crushed between two truck trays. But I've always thought it sounded suspicious. In the 1960s, there were a lot of strange accidents at the markets, especially involving people who wouldn't fall into line. The explanations Nonna was given never quite made sense, but she wasn't thinking straight because grief was all she had time for. God was not smiling on them anymore. Salvatore was not coming home. I've always imagined that as the truck reversed, my Nonna must have looked up and taken a last panic gasp because he knew his story was about to end. Then he was gone. Forever. I've always wondered what it must feel like to suddenly realise you're in the last paragraph of your story. My nonno had survived 5 years of war, but two trucks and one lousy second was all it took for him to be lost. I never got to meet him. I wish I did. Though Nonna's grief never really subsided, at some point she gathered herself. She had three boys to raise on her own, and they would need her strength and comfort. She would again have to draw on all her resilience to keep going. So, as Salvatore's story ended, another chapter of Angelina's began. She was now a broken matriarch, but also a beacon of love for her boys. Her beloved and headstrong Vincenzo quit school in order to support the family, taking over the business and staying by Angelina's side as they faced a future together without Salvatore. Chapter 3. We learn by standing on the shoulders of the wise. Sicilian proverb. Nonna may have sworn that she would never open the package that held the contents of her husband's short life, but I had other ideas. When I was in kindergarten, I found it hidden away, and from then on, I was obsessed with opening it in secret. I would cross my chubby legs on the carpet of her little Carnegie unit and search for that mysterious packet of goodies that I knew was stashed in the back of the Franco Cozzo sideboard. I would quietly untie the knot in the red and white serviette and pray to God that I wouldn't be caught, even though I knew God would be mad with me for doing it. I loved holding Nonno's driver's license in my hands, and I would stare at his picture, wondering whether he would have liked me. The face of my grandfather gave away no secrets, but I could sense a mix of fear and anger in the bright eyes that glared back at me, as though he knew what was coming for him. The smell of stale cigarettes and the feel of the old coins made me giddy with nostalgia for something I'd never known. There was a connection to my nonno that even as a child I knew was an important part of who I was. I felt like I knew him, like I could feel him in my heart, even though I was also terrified of him and his foreboding stare. As I've grown older, I've recognised that there is an essence of him that I carry with me. The spirit of a fighter, but also a shared darkness that I would continuously have to wrestle with. Whenever I have grappled with the bleak elements of my soul, I always come back to his face and the darkness I could see in his eyes. Somehow, even my childhood self knew this. So I would stare at Salvatore's face, knowing that we would always be connected, not by experience, but by character. Growing up in suburban Melbourne, I was lucky to have so much of both my parents' families around us. I don't know much about my parents' courtship other than the fact that they met at a squash court where Dad played and that they got engaged very quickly. There was talk that if my nonno was alive, there would have been no way he would have let my dad marry someone who wasn't Italian. But my mum is pretty charming, so I always believe she could have won him over. Dad was adamant that would never have been the case. I guess we will never know. It's weird to think that if Nonno hadn't had that tragic accident, I may not be here. My sister Nicole was born in 1969, and I followed 4 years later. I came along on the 15th of June, 1973, the year The Exorcist was a box office hit, and Queen Elizabeth II opened the Sydney Opera House. Funnily enough, as I got older, both exorcism and drama would feature in my days. Mum's labour with me was quick and slippery. I flew out of her with only about 20 minutes warning, so she was lucky to make it into the foyer of Cabrini Hospital in Malvern. I still like to arrive early. Lateness stresses me out. I always felt lucky to have an older sister, and Nicole and I were very close, even though I could be overexcitable and annoying. I talked a lot. My parents used to tease me, saying I had verbal diarrhea. When I was a toddler, I would obsessively follow my sister around the house, calling out, "Cole!" repeatedly. And Nicole would yell to Mum, "Make her stop!" She still loved me, though. When I was very small, she would unwittingly torture me by trying to shove me into a tiny toy pram and wheel me around like one of her dolls. My first memory is of Mum in stitches trying to tell my sister to stop because I'd grown too big for the pram, yet not being able to help me because she was laughing too hard. I remember looking down at my legs and then up at my sister with her face showing fierce determination as she tried to squish me in, while I wished myself smaller to make her happy. I started dancing when I was 2. In keeping with wanting to do everything my sister did, I would scream and cry when she was in ballet class because I wanted to join in. I was lucky that my Aunt Rosalind owned a wonderful ballet school and told my mum to just let me have a go. I leapt out of my mother's arms and my love affair with ballet began. When I wasn't at home, at school, or at ballet, I would split my time between my nonnas and my nanas. I'm Australian with Italian and Irish heritage. To some, that might seem like two very different worlds, but as a kid, it was just how my family was. My nana and grandfather on my mother's side were as strong an influence on my upbringing as my nonna. They too showered me with unconditional love and had a warm home filled with good food and happiness. My grandfather grew up in Malvern and was a St. Kevin's boy, while Nana went to Convent of the Good Shepherd and lived in Middle Park, South Melbourne Football Club country. Funny that South Melbourne is known as the Bloods, because love for that team subsequently ran through all of our veins. Nana had a cool, fashion-forward bob and a timelessly chic look, and grandfather had a sweet Bing Crosby, Fred Astaire kind of vibe. When they were young, the two of them spent their time hanging out on Middle Park Beach and going to dances and the movies. By the time I got to know them, they were just cozy old Nana and grandfather. They never strayed far from where they grew up. They had a huge house on an old disused family dairy in Malvern, and I would spend afternoons hanging out in the abandoned car yard or skulking through the remnants of the old dairy looking for adventure. They loved where they lived, and I did too. I adored being at their place, watching TV in front of the gas heater, eating biscuits and drinking tea. Cousins would pop in sporadically, so it was often a house filled with people and noise. Grandfather worked.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.